soil is our most valuable natural asset on planet Earth. It's the second biggest carbon sink, and therefore huge potential to be part of the climate solution.
We need to restore healthy soils, and we can do this through regenerative farming.
Hi, girls.
Regenerative farming is farming in harmony with nature, building soil fertility, reinstating lost biodiversity, and building public health.
Regenerative agriculture just means better agriculture. It improves biodiversity, you get great crop yields, and you can create really healthy living solutions for the people in those environments.
Having nature back into the heart of that fruit production will be transformative in so many ways.
How can regenerative agriculture be scaled? That is the key question.
Conventional agriculture is the cause for 30% of global carbon. And in a system that could actually be sequestering carbon, that just shows you how backwards and how disrupted our food system is.
Far away, harvesting wheat on the Kansas plains to feed.
We assumed after the Second World War that we needed to grow two blades of grass where one grew before, or two ears of wheat, because of the food insecurity emergency precipitated by conflict. At the end of that period, we had the emergence of chemical fertilizers and pesticides and government subsidies, in the combination of which enabled us to intensify, and then that heralded in the era of cheap food.
A report produced by the UN FAO found that the hidden costs of intensive food production are over $12 trillion more than we paid for our food at the tills. If we factored in the environmental and health costs, it would be probably three times more expensive.
The most important question of our time is, can we feed the world if we have a transition to regenerative farming systems which is scaled across the planet?
There are a number of practices that farmers can implement which will help the soil regenerate, help nature thrive, and help farming ultimately become part of the climate change solution. Minimum tillage or no tillage, which basically means less ploughing of the land, means that carbon can remain locked up in the soil. Include rotations where you might have only been growing two crops continuously. So whether it's a species-rich herbal lay or a very diverse rotation where you're having three or four different crops, rather than relying on nitrogen fertilizer to keep giving the crop all the nutrient it needs to grow, you restore the soil naturally through a period of rest. To make money off that rest period, you could graze animals, which actually have the impact of speeding up soil fertility building. Livestock actually have a really, really important role in regenerative systems. Every time the sheep poo on this patch of soil, walk on it, trample it, that's only going to increase the health of this piece of soil as well. What you really don't want is bare soil where it can get washed away or blown away, and you're losing your most valuable asset on the farm. So by putting in what we call a cover crop, it means you're locking that soil in place with roots. It literally binds it in place. You can see here it's not compacted at all. It's really nice and fluffy, which basically acts as a sponge for the water. You can see the little tiny root nodules on the clover, which is fixing nitrogen naturally from the air and fertilizing this soil. Effectively, they're natural fertilizers, and they're such brilliant ways of rebuilding soil fertility. This soil is looking really healthy. We modeled what would happen if we introduced regenerative farming across the whole of the UK. We found that we can produce enough food for a UK population with regenerative agriculture. That is absolutely replicable in other parts of the world.
In order for farmers to transition to regenerative farming practices, they need to have the knowledge, the means, and the motivation to make that transition. Sometimes the challenge for the farmer is that they're risk averse. They may feel more comfortable with the certainty of the practices that they're used to implementing than venturing into a new practice. And one way that we combat this is by implementing farmer field schools. We've been supporting almost 500,000 smallholder farmers across rice, sesame, quinoa, and other products to implement better farming practices that are good for the environment and good for their livelihoods. Through our Climate Smart and Regenerative Rice Farming programs, we've seen that regenerative agriculture practices can really positively impact farmers' yields and incomes while also reducing their carbon emissions. Farmers also need access to finance to help support the costs of transitioning. We need sourcing models and incentive systems that help to share the cost of this transition across the supply chain. As society, we have an incredible ability to innovate in the face of challenges. And today, more than ever, we have access to data and to technology that enable us to learn from the past, to build on the successes, and to implement best practices.
In general, when you're switching from a conventional practice to a regenerative practice, you have a 5-year dip where there's actually a fall off in your yield. So they can get to a higher yield, but we have to do what we call filling the dip. And so carbon credits, incentives, and companies willing to come in and commit to a higher price at the end are all examples of ways that we can help fill the dip. Scaling up regenerative agriculture, like the food system, is incredibly complex. So there's a million different steps that are laid out, but most of these are influenced by data. You actually need farm by farm, ingredient by ingredient level data that you're reporting on to be able to say, this is the practices that I'm implementing and here are the outcomes on my farm. We've mapped over 1.1 million food products. We're looking at greenhouse gas emissions, we're looking at biodiversity impacts, we're looking at blue water, we're looking at soil health. We also roll everything up into an overall ecosystem score or impact score. The more farms that we are doing that in, the better the whole data ecosystem becomes. And so using this common framework where information can then be shared easily from one farm to another, all the way up the supply chain, just makes the entire transition to a better food system easier. We help the largest companies in the world to measure their impact. Once they've measured it, we then help them abate it and make their plans to how to hit maybe net zero or whatever their internal target is. We can take that data now and you can give it to the businesses that are trying to make these transitions so that the bankers can give better rates. They're starting to reward companies that are making or farmers that are making these changes. Companies are then willing to pay more for these products that have these better outcomes and improve all of their metrics that they're internally tracking. We need to bring this together so that it can be done well and fast.
You need a bank, you need an asset manager who's going to invest in soil carbon credits, biodiversity net gain, social credits. We need insurance companies to de-risk the non-delivery of those credits. We need food companies to pay a modest premium for their sourcing. In fact, all the big food companies and retailers need to work together in a pre-competitive spirit so that one of them is not disadvantaged against others who carry on sourcing food which has come from extractive agriculture. And we can also make sure that when it comes to agricultural inputs, the polluter must pay. This will require an unparalleled degree of collaboration between government and industry.
If regenerative agriculture is taken to scale as consumers, we can expect to see greater stability in food supply because crops grown under regenerative practices tend to be more resilient to climate change and over time will tend to have higher yields.
There's various sort of pincer movements that are happening which are pushing the system in the right direction. We need to move quicker, and that's where initiatives like the Sustainable Markets Initiative are really important in bringing companies and organizations together to understand how they drive change collaboratively rather than on their own.
If we are fed by nature, we somehow understand our relationship with the world in which we find ourselves. We need to give everyone that opportunity.